regreso aquí en Auto 060 en la edición especial sobre el resumen de lo que ha sucedido en el 2013, las presentaciones, los debuts, los cambios. Así que vamos a un tercer segmento con Carl Bauer, KellyBlueBook.com, talking about the best cars of 2013.
So here we're back with Carl. Carl, we're like getting to the end of 2013, and we actually share a couple of drive events. I remember the Kia Soul was one of them, and I think we did the Santa Fe too, the Hyundai Santa Fe earlier this year, or it was last year, I don't even remember. It's confusing now.
They all blur together, don't they?
Yeah, 2013, 2014, and we're seeing 2015 cars. So let's see, what's your opinion? What was the best car or the best memory that you have for what you drove in 2013?
I think the car that surprised me the most, in a good way, was the Jaguar F-Type, and I know you've driven that too, Javier. That car is amazing. I mean, it is a viable 911 alternative, and I don't say that lightly. I don't know if I've ever said that before. The 911 is such a fabulous car, and it has such a unique proposition in the market. And if someone would have told me 3 years ago that I would be calling a Jaguar product a viable 911 alternative for someone looking for that kind of vehicle, I wouldn't have believed them. So I'm very impressed, and I just think the car is fabulous.
Yeah, and some people wouldn't still believe you. I mean, like, because obviously Porsche has a very loyal fan base. I mean, the cars are fabulous. But yeah, I completely agree with you. I actually had the opportunity to drive it recently in the Jaguar Driving Performance Academy and Homestead Miami Speedway, and that's where you really can enjoy like all the power of the great handling and all that the car has. And in general, I think I agree with you that Jaguar this year probably started to like show exactly where they're going and like really really improving from just not many years ago.
Yeah, I mean, you think about it, and, you know, Ratan Tata, who runs the huge automotive manufacturing company in India, took control of Land Rover and Jaguar, you know, several years ago from Ford. But, you know, as we know, in the car industry, nothing happens overnight. So he had to invest, and he had to start really, you know, bringing those brands back around. And I think we're just this year seeing the fruits of his labor, because the other impressive car for this past year was both the Range Rover, the full-size one, and the Range Rover Sport, the smaller one. Both of those vehicles, again, are just amazing, not only in their leap forward from the previous versions, but just amazing SUVs. They're just amazing luxury SUVs, and I think a Range Rover Sport. I mean, I drove one of those recently, and it was one of those rare days where it actually was inclement weather here in Los Angeles, raining like crazy, and I had to drive home, and I felt like king of the world, literally. I mean, the car was unstoppable. I didn't have a moment's hesitation on what the car was going to do for me in that weather situation, and of course, I've off-roaded both of them to the extreme. I just think they're fabulous cars, again, and this is just proof that Tata has invested in those two brands, and we're just seeing really the first totally new products that are coming to market since he took over. And if this is an indication of what's to come, I think you're going to see a lot more awards and a lot higher visibility and a lot better sales for the Jaguar and Land Rover products.
Yeah, speaking about sales, the Range Rover Sport is on a one-year waiting list. I mean, who would have thought, like just like a few years ago, that they would have that quote-unquote problem, which I think it's getting to be a kind of a serious problem, even though they're running the factories 24/7 over in England. I mean, a year is a lot, especially considering, as we are talking, how many products it's out there, how many new cars are there. So if you commit to a car now and wait a year, in a year there's going to be something really cool probably out there, including probably a new crossover Jaguar.
Yeah, no, the industry is changing on almost like a weekly, daily basis, so committing to a product, a purchase a year out, you're going to have to really have a commitment to not waver when you have a typical year go by these days, and all the new stuff that's introduced that's you know, bigger and brighter and better than the previous year. But I know, I remember when I drove the Sport on the first press event, and I was like, you know, probably not able to afford one anyways, but I remember thinking to myself, boy, if I wanted one of these, I'd have to, like, get on the list now. And the guys were back then, they were saying, know, if you were at all serious about thinking of wanting one for yourself, tell us now because there's already a 3 to 4 month waiting list. And that was in, like, August.
Yeah.
So now it's at a year.
A year. And they have a waiting list for the cancellation of the waiting list. So if someone cancels, you get a call from the dealership like, well, that's a new one. And actually, what I'm saying is getting to be a problem. I actually have a friend who ordered one. Hers was coming in March. They called her a few weeks ago telling her that there was a cancellation, and the particular model that was canceled on that waiting list was a little bit more expensive than the one she had ordered. But she agreed to that over the phone when they called her, and then when she got to the dealership, they told her, okay, that's fine, but then you're going to have to pay an extra $5,000 premium on top of it. And then, like, they lost her. And that's where the problem comes, because, I mean, having high demand for your vehicles is great, but if you're in the consumer experience, it's not that a good problem anymore.
Yeah, well, and I always feel frustrated. I always kind of feel bad for the manufacturers, because at the end of the day, there's the manufacturers and there's the dealers, and they operate fairly independently despite the fact that they're supposed to be partners. And it's always sad when you feel like a manufacturer is being kind of damaged or torpedoed by a bad dealer behavior, you know. And that's a good example where you had a fan of the brand and of the model who may never come back because of her dealer experience, which is unfortunate.
Well, yeah, she went out and buy a Mercedes-Benz S-Class, the new one. So, I mean, a gain for Mercedes-Benz, a loss for Range Rover. But speaking of the Mercedes-Benz S-Class, that was another car that debuted this year that is just, like, fantastic. I mean, Mercedes-Benz PR team calls it the best car in the world, and I don't think they're that far away from that denomination. What do you think about it?
Well, we just keep getting closer and closer to this driving yourself, you know, cars that drive themselves and don't need any human input. And I know that the S-Class is kind of at the head of that technology curve. And, yeah, it's just, you know, these guys know that premium brands are really under the gun because, you know, think about it, Javier. It used to be the difference between a premium brand and a non-premium brand was pretty substantial in the quality of the seat leather and the quietness of the cabin at highway speeds and all. Well, now all the non-premium cars have really quiet interiors, and they've got navigation systems, they've got supple leather seats available if you pay a little more. So the premium automakers just have to keep working harder and harder to differentiate themselves, and the S-Class is the top of the Mercedes-Benz line. So they didn't mess around. They just created a car that was just a whole other level up again on the technology and on the luxury and the safety. It's an amazing car.
Yeah, and speaking of Mercedes again, like, they also another car on the other extreme of their lineup, the CLA came out this year, and they like doing great with that car. I mean, maybe not as bad as the Range Rover Sport waiting list, but like they're selling the new CLA, which starts officially under $30,000. They're having great success with that car. I also love that car. What do you think about that one?
No, I think it was a brilliant move for them. They know that if they could put an official MSRP where the first number is a 2 and not a 3, that's going to draw people in. And once they're in there, you know, Kelly, we're tracking the transaction prices, and the cars are averaging at like $37,000. So, you know, they're getting enough people who want to come in and see the car to buy them, and they're not even trying to get them in the lower-priced versions. They're just going ahead, right ahead, and paying the money to get a really nicely equipped one. So they're kind of losing the whole low-priced entry-level thing in the process, but that's getting them interested and in the door, which is exactly what Mercedes wanted, and it's working perfectly. You wonder how thin they can slice that onion, because they do have the C-Class, which I believe we're going to see the next version of in Detroit next month. But, you know, you got to think that the CLA is going to start intruding on the C-Class, which was their previous, you know, entry-level car. It's going to have to start cannibalizing those sales somewhat.
Yeah, and we're going to have a life in the next segment, because we were talking about the next segment. We're going to talk about what we're going to see in the Detroit Auto Show, and we're going to see the new C-Class. So we'll talk about that a little bit later. Mercedes-Benz is also announced during the LA Auto Show that they're coming up with the B-Class electric, at least for now. So they're even getting lower and lower into the, not the quality, but the size. So, and as we know, a famous phrase from the former PR guy at Mercedes-Benz, Jeff Day, he said, it's easier to get from the penthouse to the lobby than from the lobby to the penthouse. And that's apparently what Mercedes-Benz is doing, right?
Yeah, no, you're right. They have the branding and the premium reputation, and so they know that if they just start making smaller, less expensive cars, they're going to pull in a lot of people who otherwise couldn't afford their vehicles up until this point. And, of course, the electric thing just kind of keeps getting more and more noise, so it also opens them up to kind of the green, environmental-oriented shoppers as well. So it's, again, a good move to have that all-electric B-Class coming to the U.S.
Yeah, we are having this great conversation. There are so many cars that we can talk about, and we only have like one more minute in this segment. But Tesla kind of like made the big move this year, and like they're like not only making consumers happy, they're also creating a roar in the way they sell cars with a new way of having not dealerships but like showrooms in shopping centers, and so they're changing the whole industry, right?
Yeah, and it's going to be a challenge because, you know, I like to say that you know, there's a few things you can't beat. That's death, taxes, and the dealer lobbying body in the U.S. And so we're going to see if Tesla and Elon Musk can actually, you know, come up with a non-traditional purchase system, because the dealers in this country have a lot of influence over how they want everyone to have to follow the same franchise dealer laws. But Elon wants to go a different route, wants to have more like, you know, like you said, Apple showrooms, so maybe they'll go that way. We'll see.
Yeah, we'll see that, and I think it's starting to happen, so we'll see what goes on that. So, again, Carl Bauer from KellyBlueBlue.com, and when we come back for the final segment of this special edition of Auto 0 to 60 here in Christina Radio Network, we're going to talk about what we're going to see at a Detroit Auto Show in just a few days. So, we'll be back here with Carl Bauer in Auto 060.